بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه. أما بعد, this is our 32nd lesson going through the book مختصر أبي شجع في الفقه على مذهب الإمام الشافعي رحمه الله تعالى, author by القاضي أبو الحسين أحمد بن الحسين بن أحمد الأصفهاني رحمه الله تعالى. الحمد لله, we are still in كتاب البيوع and we have arrived at فصل وإحياء المواد جائز بشرطين. إحياء المواد deals with the cultivation of barren land. So what is meant by المواد? المواد refers to land that has no owner, nor does it have anyone benefiting from said land. And so anybody who gets there first, and we're going to see what kind of person is allowed to get there first and cultivate said land, either by building a home upon the land or building a well within the land or growing crops on the land and so on, he will become owner of that land. And so إحياء المواد is one of the ways that a person can become an owner of something, right? And so obtaining ownership of something, one of the ways that you can, there are around 8 or so ways in which you can obtain ownership of material. One of the ways in which you can attain ownership of something is by إحياء المواد, meaning you come across barren land that is not owned by anybody, who has not been owned by anybody, and nobody is benefiting from it, and then you build it, you cultivate it, such that you produce something, right, like a home or crop, a field that you're going to irrigate crops with or whatever, right, or مثلا you're going to make a well out of it or something, right? By doing this, you have brought this land back to life again, i.e. back to use again, back to being of benefit to the people again, right? And so there's something which is جائز, something which is permissible, بشرطين, if two conditions are fulfilled. The first condition, أن يكون المحيي مسلما, that the one doing this cultivation must be a Muslim, i.e. the one who is coming across this barren land and then cultivating it, the one doing this must be a Muslim. And so the disbeliever is not allowed. So if you're in a Muslim land, a land that is ruled by the Sharia, and a kafir comes across a piece of land within this Muslim nation, and he finds that this land is what? It's mawat. It's barren land, and nobody owns it, nobody's ever owned it. The kafir, is he allowed to do cultivation of that land, and then by doing cultivation he can assume ownership over that piece of land? The answer is no, he is not allowed to do this, even if he is given express permission from the Muslim leader. He is not allowed to do this according to the madhab. طيب, وأن تكون الأرض حرة لم يجري عليها ملك لمسلم. Then the second condition is that it must be free land, i.e. land that has never been owned by a Muslim before. Land that, so the mawat here, this barren land, must be land that has never been owned by a Muslim before. If this land was previously owned by a Muslim, i.e. a Muslim came, cultivated this land, and then assumed ownership of that land because of the cultivation that he did, even if he was to leave it later on, even if this item or this thing that he cultivated the land with became destroyed, this land is not yours to cultivate and then assume ownership of. Why? Because a Muslim came before you and assumed ownership of that land through cultivation. However, if this Muslim came before you, left the land, and the land became kharab again, it became barren again, right? Who does the land belong to? The land belongs to the person who came before you still. However, what the ruler does is he assumes control over said land. He assumes control over said land. And what he does is that he can either, number one, keep the land for the owner, i.e. close off the land and keep it for the owner until the owner returns, or he could potentially sell the land and take that money, look after it until the owner returns, and then when the owner returns he can give him that money which he sold. We're talking about the Muslim ruler here. طيب, and there are other ways in which he can look after this land, but the shahid here is that the land does not belong to you. If that land, if that barren land was cultivated by a Muslim before you and he thereby assumed ownership of said land, you cannot come afterwards and say this land is mine, even if the land became barren after. So that's what it's meant by this condition, وَأَن تَكُونَ الْأَرْضُ حُرَّةً لَمْ يَجْرِ عَلَيْهَا مِلْكٌ لِمُسْلِمٍ لم يجري عليها ملك لمسلم. نعم. لأن يوثر رحمه الله said, وصفة الإحياء ما كان في العادة عمارة للمحيا. Whatever can be deemed cultivation of the land is called الإحياء, according to the customs of the people. And so if you want to build a home upon this land, or you want to build a well upon this land, then you must build something that resembles a well, or that resembles, that gives you all the hallmarks of a home, or all the hallmarks of a well, or all the hallmarks of مثلا a field that's going to grow crops مثلا, right? You have to do that. Meaning that someone who then comes later on and sees this land that you have cultivated, he sees what is normally to be expected from your cultivation, i.e. if you're cultivating a field of crops, he will then see something that resembles a field of crops, right? If he sees, if you are coming across a barren land, and you see this barren land that has belonged to someone, and he's growing it, and he's مثلاً building it with, or he's cultivating it مثلاً with a home مثلاً, and you come and you see all the hallmarks of a home, then this land has been what? Has been assumed it is then assumed that this land belongs to the one who cultivated that land, of course, if he meets those conditions we mentioned, i.e. he's a Muslim and no one previously owned said land, right? However, let's say I come across a barren land, and I just put an arrow stick, or I just put a stick in to label that this is my land. That's not sufficient. That is not sufficient. That is not considered ما كان في العادة عمارة للمحيا, right? And so if you do this method and you find it, it may happen, right? Someone comes and he comes across a land which is barren and not owned by anybody, it's a mawad, and he puts a stick in to bagzi it, to say that this is belong, it belongs to me, it's my land now, right? But he never ever cultivates it, he never ever actually puts any effort into cultivating it or bringing something out of it that is considered actually something of benefit to the community. And so what this person, what's upon this person is that the ruler forces him to either cultivate the land or to give up the land. You either cultivate the land or you leave this land and someone else will come and take over it and do imara of it, right? I.e. building it up and cultivating it. And so you can't, and the reason why this is done, the reason why you're forced to either cultivate or step aside is because this is mal, this is wealth, right? And you're wasting wealth, right? And we know that we are not allowed to waste wealth. إن المبذرين كانوا إخوان الشياطين وكان الشيطان لربه كفورا. We're not allowed to waste wealth. طيب. And so if you come across a barren land and you just put an arrow or a stick into it to label this as your own land, and you don't do anything with it, you don't cultivate it, you don't do anything with it, then that is not sufficient enough for you to assume ownership of that land. And so you are to be then commanded either cultivate the land or move out of the land. And if you don't cultivate the land, then you are told to move out, and يعني someone else will then assume ownership of that land. طيب. Then the author رحمه الله he said ويجب بذل الماء بثلاثة شرائط. Now the author رحمه الله he mentions when is it obligatory for a person to give out water? When is it obligatory upon a person to give out water? And this is very linked back to أحياء الموات. Generally speaking, when you want to cultivate land, you're going to have water, right? You're going to مثلا, let's say someone cultivated a land by building a well. He cultivated a barren land by building a well. Now this well has water in it, right? Now let's say you are, this is your land, and someone comes to you and he asks for water from your well. If three conditions are fulfilled, it becomes obligatory upon you to give him water. You see? So water, generally speaking, if someone asks you for water and you give them the water, that's a sadaqah. That's the asl, right? However, if three conditions are fulfilled, it becomes obligatory upon you to give him the water or to give them the water, right? And the reason why the author mentioned it under the chapter of Hiya al-Malat is because generally speaking, when you want to cultivate a barren land, the common form is to build a well. Number two, أن يفضل عن, sorry, number one, so there are three conditions. The first condition, أن يفضل عن حاجته, meaning the water that you have in that well is in excess of what you need. It's in excess of what you need. So your needs are already fulfilled, and the water that you have is what? Is excess to that. Meaning, if you don't have enough water to fulfill your own needs, it's not obligatory for you to give away the water. Right. Number two, وَأَنْ يَحْتَاجَ إِلَيْهِ غَيْرُهُ لِنَفْسِهِ أَوْ لِبَهِيمَتِهِ. The one who's asking for the water, he must need it for his own self, i.e. to satisfy his own self, meaning I am thirsty, I need it for my own self, or to quench the thirst of my animals, right? Or your riding vehicle, مثلا. Right? And so this person saying, I need water, right? I need water for my own self. I need to quench my own thirst. Or I have animals with me that I need to quench their thirst. However, if he comes and he says to you, I need water to water my own crops, right? Or I need water to use for anything outside of my own self, or the riding beast that I have, or the animals that I have that is with me to quench their thirst. If it's anything outside of those two reasons, it is not obligatory for you to give him that water. It only becomes obligatory when, number one, you have more water or you have excess water than what you need. Number two, the person who's asking for the water needs it to quench his thirst and the thirst of his animals that are with him, be it his riding beast or the animals that he has in terms of his flock of sheep or something, مثلا, right? لبهيمته. Number three, وأن يكون مما يستخلف في بئر أو عين, meaning the water that you're going to give to this person, it must come from a source in which the water will be replenished, will be replaced, right? And so that is generally in a well or a spring. So if you're in a إحياء, if you're in a mawat, a barren land, and you cultivated it by producing springs, so you, as we know, the spring is what? It is كل ما نبع من الأرض, water that gushes forth from the land, from the earth, right? And so let's say you built a spring, or you built a fountain, right? Or you built a well, right? This well, when you take out the water, new water will take its place, right? It will be replenished, it will be replaced. If that condition is fulfilled, then you are it becomes obligatory upon you, along with, of course, meeting the other two conditions, it becomes obligatory upon you to give him water. طيب. However, let's say if you had water in a bucket, you had water in a bucket, giving him the water, will the water that's in the bucket that you gave out be replaced? The answer is no. And so you have not met this condition, meaning it's not obligatory for you to give him the water. So giving water to somebody becomes obligatory if three conditions are fulfilled. Number one, that the water is in excess, you have excess water than what you need. Number two, the one who's asking for it needs it to quench his thirst or the thirst of his animals. Number three, that the water source that you are giving him from, you are able to replace that water that you have given with new water. And that's generally in the case of what? Wells and springs, because there is a natural water source, right, which is replacing the water that has been given to this person who asked for the water. And so bidhrul ma' becomes obligatory upon three conditions being met. If these three conditions are not met, then bidhrul ma', giving out water, is something which is recommended and something which you will be rewarded for doing. However, you will not be held sinful for not doing. طيب, والله تعالى أعلم. Then the author, rahimahullah, he said, فَصْلٌ وَالْوَقْفُ جَائِزٌ بِثَلَاثَةِ شَرَائِطٍ. And so here now the author, rahimahullah, he goes on to speak about the masail pertaining to al-waqf. Al-waqf refers to an endowment, and so it's a type of sadaqah. It's a type of charitable deed that a person does, where he donates a fixed asset, where you donate a fixed asset that is able to provide a benefit or able to produce any form of financial return. مثلاً, you donate a building, or you donate land, or you donate a well, right? And you have no intention of reclaiming the value that is gained from that wealth. طيب. And that is what the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, is hinting at when he means by al-waqf, right? And so he says al-waqf ja'iz, doing this is ja'iz, and the reason why you're doing it, of course, is taqarruban ila Allah, to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is one form of sadaqah jariyah. Right, this is one form of sadaqah jariyah. And so he says that al-waqf is permissible if three conditions are fulfilled. Number one, أن يكون مما ينتفع به مع بقاء عينه. It must be something that can be benefited from whilst its essence remains. For example, a piece of land, or for example, a home, or for example, a well, right? A well, you can benefit from it and its essence remains. The well actually remains. You take what the means of benefit from the well is to get water from it, right? And so once the water is collected and you benefited from it, the well still remains, right? يبقى عينه, right? And so that's one condition that must be fulfilled in order for this waqf to be jaiz. So if someone مثلا comes to you and says, I want to make waqf food, is that allowed? لا, because as you benefit from the food, لا يبقى عينه, right? The essence of the food is gone, right? As soon as you benefit from it, as soon as you consume it, right? And so that you can't have food as waqf. Good. The second condition, وَأَنْ يَكُونَ عَلَىٰ أَصْلٍ مَوْجُودٍ وَفَرْعٍ لَا يَنْقَطِعٍ. So here now the author, rahimahullah, is essentially differentiating between a waqf that is done ala jihatin amma and a waqf that is done ala jihatin khasa. What's meant by ala jihatin amma? It's a general waqf, meaning the beneficiaries of this waqf is what? General. For example, you build a masjid and you put it as a waqf, and this is of course a general benefit. Everybody who's a Muslim is going to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and needs to pray in this masjid can come and pray in the masjid, right? So this is something which is general. Or مثلا you build a home or you build a house and you leave it as waqf for any poor person to come or any عادر سبيل to come or any any person who is homeless to come and stay or anyone who is an orphan that can come and stay, right? So this is a general waqf, waqf for a general population, right? And then you have a waqf على جهة خاصة, meaning you say I leave this home as waqf for fulan, for X individual. This is waqf على جهة خاصة. Or مثلا I leave this home as waqf for my children. طيب, this is what أصل, this is something which is a waqf على جهة خاصة. It's specific to a certain individual or a certain person, right? And so if you are doing waqf على جهة خاصة, then there must be an أصل which is موجود, meaning the one whom you're doing the waqf to, the one whom you're giving this home as a waqf, right, has to be present. Has to be present. We call it asl. We call this person whom the waqf is being given to, we call him an asl. For example, you have a son, and this son is alive. This son is alive, and you say, this home, awqaftuhu, I give it as a waqf for my son. This is permissible, and we call the son asl mawjood. Asl mawjood. Good. However, if I say, I have a home, and I want to give up this home as waqf for my son that is to be born. My son that is yet to be born. Is this a valid waqf? This is an invalid waqf. Why? Because his waqf, which is munqati' al-awwal, the asl is not mawjood. The one whom the waqf is to be given to, he's not present, he's not here. It's not here, right? And so we can't do this as waqf. Okay? That's what's meant by an yakuna ala asl mawjood. Okay, now I have the son present. I need to also come with the second condition, which is wa far'in la yanqati'. Meaning this son that I am given this home as waqf, he must have a progeny that does not cut off. He must have progeny, or there must be something that successes that come after him which does not cut off. Meaning I say مثلا, I give my home as waqf to my son, and then his children, and then his children, and if his children cut off, i.e. if there is no children left for him, I give it to the waqf to the poor people. وَفَرْعٍ لَا يَنْقَطَعِ. Now when it comes to this specific point وَفَرْعٍ لَا يَنْقَطَعِ, there is خِلَاف بين الشَّافِعِيَّة concerning whether this is a valid condition or not, right? And you find that the راجح, the correct opinion, the more stronger opinion within the madhab is that this is not actually a condition, right? And if a person مثلا was to say, I leave this place as waqf for my son and then his children, and then I stopped at there, I didn't say if the children are not present, give the waqf to the poor people, right? And then it became now jiha amma, after it was jiha khasa, right? That's allowed. There's no problem with that. But what if someone doesn't have a far'a, i.e. far'un yanqat, or he has a far'a, which is what? Going to cut off. Method. How am I going to be 100% certain that my son is going to have children? He might not have children, right? And so when I say, I leave this home as a waqf for my son and then his children, but there is no children for my son, right? What happens in this scenario? Is this a valid waqf or an invalid waqf? The Shafi'iyya differed. Abu Shuja' took the opinion that is what? وَفَرْعٍ لَا يَنْقَطْعِ is a condition. You have to have a far' a succession from the person whom you've given this home or this place as waqf or this material as waqf to, right? There has to be a succession which does not break off, which does not break up, right? Which does not cut off, right? لَا يَنْقَطْعِ. That's the condition that Abu Shuja' put in. But the Nawawi and the Rajih opinion within the Madhab is that this is not actually a condition which is required. And so if a person مثلا did have a far'a الذي ينقطع, مثلا he says I give this home as waqf to my son and then his children, and then ثم سكت, then he kept quiet, then in this scenario what happens is if the children perish and no one is left, i.e. انقطع, then what happens is you look at the closest relative to the one who set up this place as a waqf, and you give the home or you give that item or give that place to them, right? And then still the waqf continues, and in that case the waqf will still continue. طيب, that's the more rajih opinion within the madhab. Wallahu alam. The third condition, wa an la yakuna fi mahzurin, meaning this item or this thing that you put up as waqf, it must not be something which is haram. So you can't say put out this this home as waqf for clubbing or for a nightclub, right? Or مثلا I leave this home as a waqf, or I leave this school as a waqf for what? For teaching homosexuality or teaching something which is haram in the religion, right? Or something which is مثلا as a pub, right? I convert this school into a pub and I leave this pub as a waqf for people to drink alcohol in. كل هذا محظور. Or مثلا I leave this home to be a what? To be a whorehouse مثلا, right? To house a prostitute or something like that. هذا لا يجوز. Right, this is something which is not allowed, right? Because the whole purpose of the waqf is what? At-taqarrubu ila Allah azza wa jal. To get closer to Allah azza wa jal. And you can't get closer to Allah azza wa jal with what? With evil deeds or with evil actions. طيب والله أعلم. Then the author رحمه الله he said, وَهُوَ عَلَى مَا شَرَطَ الْوَاقِفُ مِنْ تَقْدِيمٍ أَوْ تَأْخِيرٍ أَوْ تَسْوِيَةٍ أَوْ تَفْضِيلٍ. But before that, Imam Al-Qadhi Abu Shuja, he left out two extra conditions. Number one, that the waqf is forever. Meaning, you can't say, I give this home up as a waqf for 1 month. لا لا لا. يشترط فيها التأبيد للتأجيل. Right? And so you have to condition for it eternity. Meaning, forever. Not for a specific a limited amount of time and then it's no longer considered a waqf. هذا خطأ. You can't do that. Right? Number two, this waqf, you can't put upon it a تعليق. Meaning, you can't say, if fulan comes, I will put this home up as waqf. هذا لا يجوز. You can't do that. Right? And so the waqf cannot have any ta'liqat upon it. Meaning you can't say, if X is to happen, then I will put my home up as a waqf, or I'll put this up as a waqf. Like, you can't do that. So you can't have a waqf conditioned, you can't have something external attached onto the waqf as a condition for you to do that waqf, or for you to enact out the process of putting up this item as a waqf. If it hinges on something else, then this is an invalid waqf. طيب والله أعلم. Then the author رحمه الله he said, وهو على ما شرط الواقف من تقديم أو تأخير أو تسوية أو تفضيل. Now the واقف, the one who's actually making this endowment, he has the option to put someone ahead and put someone behind. He has the option of putting someone behind and putting someone ahead. He has the option of making people equal, and he also has the option of choosing one over the other. مثلا he has 5 sons and one of the sons are more scholarly than the other sons, and so he chooses that son as what? As the one who's going to take his home or inherit or to take from him in the home as part of waqf. So مثلا says أوقفت هذا الدار, I make this house موقوف as a waqf for my most knowledgeable son. For my most knowledgeable son, right? And so the most knowledgeable son has been given precedence over his other brothers, right? In getting this home as part of my waqf, lillahi ta'ala, right? Or مثلا, I say, my waqf comes, I leave this place as a waqf for my sons and then their sons, right? And so their sons, so the grandsons are what? They're mutakhirin, they are later, right? You've put ahead these sons in front of the grandson. So it's taqdeem and ta'khir. Here, or مثلا you put it equal, so every single son of mine has an equal share or has an equal portion of my home that I've put out that I've put as waqf. بين سويتو بينهم, I gave them equally, so they all live in the house equally and they all have that house equally as the waqf, which is على الجهة الخاصة. طيب والله تعالى أعلم. Then the author رحمه الله he said, فصل وكل ما جاز بيعه جازت هبته. So now the author رحمه الله goes on to talk about a مسألة pertaining to الهبة. الهبة refers to a gift, meaning that you present something to someone as a gift for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is what's called a هبة. For example, I gift you this book. For example, I gift you this this phone. For example, I gift you this this pen. For example, I gift you whatever is allowed for a person to sell. كل ما جاز بيعه جازت هبته. Everything that a person is allowed to sell, everything that if you were to sell, you have met the conditions for the permissibility of that sale, of that transaction, you are allowed to give as a gift. For example, I gift you this car, I gift you this phone, I gift you this PlayStation, I gift you this laptop, I gift you this coffee machine, I gift you this, I gift you that. You are allowed to sell all of these things. But can you gift, مثلا, alcohol? لا. We know in this country, they love gifting alcohol. Why? You go to a person's house, you give them a gift of alcohol. And لا يجوز. Right? هذا لا يجوز. طيب, why? Because you're not allowed to sell alcohol. Right, and we spoke about this in our early classes. طيب. And so this is the ضابط. كل ما جاز بيعه جازت هبته. Anything that a person is allowed to sell, of course, when you sell it, of course, it's in a valid form, right? You are allowed to give as a gift for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. طيب. Then the author رحمه الله he said, ولا تلزم الهبة إلا بالقبض. Meaning that this هبة, remember, you have the one who's doing the gifting, person A, and the one who's being gifted, person B, and the item that's being gifted, that's item C, مثلا. طيب. And so we know that we've spoken about the item. وكل ما جاز بيعه جازت هبته. So we've spoken about the item. Now we're talking about when does a hibah become binding. When does the transaction of hibah become binding? He says, وَلَا تَلْزَمُ الْهِبَةُ إِلَّا بِالْقَبْضِ. The hibah, the gift, does not become binding until the one who's being gifted, i.e. the one who's getting the gift or the one who's receiving the gift, the recipient, actually takes control of the item that he's being gifted with. So for example, let's say I'm gifting somebody a coffee machine, right? Let's say I bought a coffee machine and I intend to gift it to my brother, person B. Person B does not become the owner of that coffee machine until he what? Collects it, until it is given to him. إِلَّا بِالْقَبْضِ. Meaning, as long as I haven't yet gifted, i.e. given this this item to him, and he hasn't collected it with his hand, as long as that hasn't happened yet, i.e. it's not yet under his possession yet, right? As long as that hasn't happened, then the transaction hasn't gone through. The transaction hasn't gone through. So for example, let's say I went to the shop and I bought a coffee machine, and I intended to gift this coffee machine to my younger brother. That was my intention. However, I turned back on that intention, and I hadn't yet gifted the coffee machine to my brother. Or even, I even told my brother, I intend to give you my coffee machine as a gift, but he hasn't yet taken possession of that coffee machine. I can renege on that deal. I can renege on that gift. However, if, as the author rahimahullah mentioned, وَإِذَا قَبَضَهَا الْمَوْهُوبُ لَهُ لَمْ يَكُنْ لِلْوَاهِبِ أَنْ يَرُجِعَ فِيهَا. However, if this coffee machine that I intended to give to my younger brother, I actually gave it to my younger brother, meaning my younger brother was in possession of this coffee machine, then me, as the one who did the gifting, I can no longer renege on this deal, meaning I am not allowed to go back and collect that coffee machine from him. Say basically, give it back to me. I can't do that. I'm not even allowed to buy it back from him either, right? As the hadith of Umar radiallahu ta'ala mentioned, Sahih Bukhari, right? I'm not even allowed to buy it back. Khalas, it's gone. It belongs to al-wahib. It belongs to al-mawhub lahu. It belongs to the one who was gifted that coffee machine. And of course, the famous ahadith that have come concern this, al-a'idu fi hibatihi kal-kalbi yaqi'u thumma ya'udu fih, as mentioned in the hadith, right? And you have other ahadith as well, like مثلا لا يحل لرجل مسلم أن يعطي العطية ثم يرجع فيها, right? As reported by Abu Dawood وغيره, right? I think Ashab al-Sunnah report that hadith. That's what the first hadith reported in Bukhari and Muslim. But anyways, back to the point here, which is that if you now have, first of all, you brought the item, you wanted to give it as a gift to your brother or to anybody, and you actually gave it. So now, halas, this item is now in the possession of the one whom you're gifting this item to. You cannot renege on that deal. Halas, it's now in his possession. You now cannot return on it. However, the author gave an exception. He said, illa an yakuna warida, except if you are a parent. And when we say walid here, we mean by it anyone who is what? Considered a parent to you. For example, your mother, your father, your grandfather, your grandmother, like that. طيب. So anyone who's considered a parent to you, he is allowed. Of course, جواز مع الكراهة, he is allowed. You can even say, instead of saying جواز مع الكراهة, you can say it has, it can range from ندب to pure جواز to جواز مع الكراهة, and sometimes even مكروه. Right, it can range depending upon the specific context, specific situation. But the asl is that the parent is allowed to return and to renege on a gift that he gave to his child. So, for example, let's say you're a father and you gave your son a PlayStation 5. As we know, currently PlayStation 5 is the thing that is in style today. Right, that's what the children like, right? And so you brought your child a PlayStation 5 and you gifted it to him. You gave it to him as a hibah. وَهَبْتُكَ هَذَا الْPlayStation 5. I gift you this PlayStation 5 to your child, right? And your child was playing it. ثُمَّ and then غَلَبَ عَلَيْكَ, it became clear to you that this kid, the reason why he's using the PlayStation 5 or the usage that he is or the importance that he's given to this gift that you have given him, right, this PS5, is turning him away from his studies. Can you now renege on that deal and say, give me back the PlayStation 5 and take it away from him? Yes, you can do that. You can do that as a parent. You can do that as a parent. And of course, in this case, it will be what? Mandu, because your child, if it's getting in the way of his studies, for example, or his religious learning or something like that, then of course, you can take that away from him. You can take it away from him. And so, and this is of course the basis for this is the hadith of Nu'man ibn Bashirin radiyallahu anhu wa arda, right, in Bukhari. And so here there's an exception. وَإِذَا قَبَضَهَا الْمَوْهُومُ لَهُ لَمْ يَكُنْ لِلْوَاهِبِ أَنْ يَرْجِعَ فِيهَا إِلَّا أَنْ يَكُونَ وَالِدًا. Except if he is a parent. If he's a parent, then he is allowed to renege on a gift that he gave. طيب, and we spoke about the broad definition of a walid. طيب. Then the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, وَإِذَا أَعْمَرَ شَيْئًا أَوْ أَرْقَبَهُ كَانَ لِلْمُعْمَرِ أَوْ لِلْمُرْقَبِ وَلِوَرَثَتِهِ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ. So here the author, rahimahullah, talking about two مسائل, مسألة العمرة and مسألة الرقبة. مسألة العمرة refers to gifting somebody a house, مثلا, and you say that this gift is only for the duration of your lifetime, meaning after you die, i.e. the one who's being gifted, after he dies, that item returns back to me. So you're putting in a condition. However, in the Sharia, this condition is considered batil, and this transaction is deemed as a hibah, meaning that the ahkam that we spoke about for hibah apply here as well, meaning that this person whom the house has been gifted to, when he dies, it does not return back to the one who did the gifting, rather it goes to the waratha, the inheritors of the person who the house was gifted to, right? And so this condition is what is not looked at, it's not considered, it is batil. And so al-umrah refers to someone who's saying to you, here, I gift you this house for your lifetime, for your lifespan, meaning when you die, the house comes back to me. That's what al-umrah is. However, when a person does this, the hukum that is given is hukum al-hibah, meaning that what you have done, even though you mentioned this, it's that what you mentioned is not considered, rather it's treated as though it's a hibah, a gift, meaning when that person dies, the house does not come back to you, rather it goes to the inheritors of that person who died. Likewise, al-ruqba. Al-ruqba, it's like al-umrah, but you're not waiting for his lifetime. Rather, you're saying, we're going to wait for whoever of us dies first. Meaning, you say, I gift you this house on the condition that if one of us dies, the house returns to the one who is still alive. Right? And so, method, you have person A, person B. Person A gifts person B a house, and he says, the house is yours until, or I gift you this house until one of us dies. So if I die first, then the house goes to yours. It belongs to you. It's yours. I.e. you keep the house. And if you die first, the house comes back to me. This is al-ruqba. And again, this is a condition which is not considered. Rather, if you do this, then the transaction is put through as a hibah. It's put through as a gift. Meaning that if that person dies, the house does not come back to you. Rather, it goes to the inheritors of the one who died, the one who the house was gifted to. So al-umrah and al-ruqba, the reason why the author put it under bab al-hibah or faslun fil hibah is because the hukm that is given to a person who does umrah and the hukm that is given to a person who does ruqba is hukm al-hibah. We treat it as though it's a hibah, meaning those conditions that he put in are not considered and are not valid. And that's why the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, لا تعمروا ولا ترقبوا, right, hadith al-sunan. Do not do umrah and do not do ruqba. Why? Because of this. Because if you do it, the house ain't coming back to you. Even if, مثلاً, you wish for the house to come back to you, it's not going to come back to you. It's going to go to the inheritors of the one who died, the one who you gifted this house to. Because a umrah and a ruqba, the hukm that it is given is hukmu al-hibah. And that's what the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, is mentioning here when he says, وَإِذَا أَعْمَرَ شَيْئًا أَوْ أَرْقَبَهُ كَانَ لِلْمُعْمَرِ أَوْ لِلْمُرْقَبِ وَلِوَرَثَتِهِ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ. هذا والله أعلم مصطفي بإذن الله. As we have come to the end of this lesson, سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.